see doctors, right? They always look cool in the hospital, right? They got their hookup on. I mean, it makes them look official. And no matter what they're doing, you feel like every time I see them, I get a pain. Something hurts me, and I want to talk to them, you know? But just it looks cool. I feel like I should have been a doctor of some sort. Anyway, this is part of my illustration for today. I'll leave this right here, kind of leave that hanging there for a little while. See what that'll do for you. This is also another one of my illustrations for today. It's kind of cool. I've been checking my blood pressure lately, and having a pretty little 11-year-old girl, I'm finding that this does not have enough digits for my blood pressure. Now that I have Jessica. Those of you that have little boys and girls too, boys seem to be easier. This morning I want you to turn in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Right after Colossians. Oh, release the little children now. They're back there pointing at their little kids, and I'm thinking, is somebody else singing? And I didn't know that Verdell was singing a song today. They're pointing at Verdell. I said, all right, you know, I mean, I'll let him do something. Thank you. I'm so sorry. Church, I want you to turn in your Bibles, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And the title of my message this morning is The Vital Signs of a True Christian Friend. The Vital Signs of a True Christian Friend. You know, yesterday, Diane's son, Papa, and my son, Timothy, were over on Union Boulevard. And they were riding their bikes, and they saw something that looked like a guy working under his car on the sidewalk. He was laying on the sidewalk. His head was almost under the tire. In between the sidewalk and the tire. It looked like somebody checking their brakes or a hubcap or something. As they got closer, they realized it was a little old lady. So what they did, I asked them yesterday after, they were actually heroes, I guess, because the lady had been there all day. She had fallen and she had been there on Union Boulevard all day. And so they knocked on a few doors and asked a couple of people if they would call 911. They see these two little Puerto Rican boys, you know, and thinking they're out of place in this neighborhood. We're not calling anything. One lady said, well, who is it? They said, it's a lady out here. They said, well, what's her name? What's her address? They said, we don't know. She's laying down. I said, well, I'm not giving my address. And they closed the door on myself. He finally went. Thank the Lord. He's got some consistency there. And he went and asked another person. And they called 911. And the little old lady was finally taken. But I asked him and Papa, what did you first think when you saw this lady? They said, was she moving? Was she breathing? Was she alive? Thank the Lord for good little boys, right?
Amen.
Thank the Lord for that. Thank the Lord for good little boys. But I thought to myself, what a wonderful illustration for what I wanted to share with you this morning. Vital signs. What are vital signs? I mean, you get a stethoscope and it'll let you hear the heartbeat and let you know if there's a pulse. If you were to see a building burning or maybe a traffic accident and you're at a distance, at a disadvantage, you would probably want to say, is anyone moving? Can you see anyone moving? Because you'd want to know, because we know that that's a vital sign of life, isn't it? That the presence of life is movement, right? Is anyone moving? Is there a pulse? Is there a heartbeat inside? That would let you know if the physical body is alive. And sometimes if the pulse is faint, you might have to go down and listen or put your ear next to the lungs or look at the lungs and see if it's breathing, because breath is also a vital sign of life. Are you with me this morning?
Amen.
The vital signs of a physical body are movement. You know it's alive when it moves. The vital sign of a body is pulse. Is it beating? Is it pumping blood? And the third vital sign is that of breath. Is there air? Is there life in there? Are you following me?
Amen.
And this morning I wanted to talk about the vital signs of a true spiritual friend. How can we know if we as we as Christian friends are alive? I begin to look out into the world sometimes, and I see people that profess to be believers and profess to be Christians, and I wonder, why don't you tell anybody? Why isn't there any movement if you believe in this Jesus? Why isn't there any pulse if you believe in this Jesus? Why isn't there any soul breath if you believe in this Jesus? Are you following me?
Amen.
So many of you who are guests today might think, well, I guess they brought me to indoctrinate me or to try to get me to believe in this pastor, maybe in this church. And what most of you friends today are going to find out is the message is primarily for the person who brought you.
Amen.
Did you say amen?
Amen.
So our physical body has vital signs, ways that we can detect the presence of life. But I think that our spiritual walk also has a way that we can detect if it has life. Can you say amen?
Amen.
I want to show you one text. One scripture is what I'm using this morning that will demonstrate all three of the vital signs. That is of movement, that of pulse, and that of breath. Amen?
Amen.
1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8 says, so affectionately longing for you, we were well pleased to impart to you not only the gospel of God, but also our own lives, because you had become so dear to us. In other versions, NIV or the source, it says, we loved you so much that we were willing to impart to you not only the gospel of God, but our very lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. And all three vital signs are found in that one statement. I want to share something with you. The vital sign of movement, first of all, this is about Paul and his friend called Silas. And they would go around from town to town in Thessalonica and Philippi and Colossus and Galatia, all the towns of the Middle East, and they would go through telling people about this Jesus that they had met. And while they were on this journey, in the book of Acts in the Bible and many other books speak of the horrendous way that they were treated and many of their near-death experiences. And I began to say to myself, how could this guy share such a gospel of love when he was treated so rudely, treated so meanly, almost killed, thrown in prison?
Amen.
And there's where God began to give me the message for you this morning. The first vital sign is the vital sign of movement, motion. Are you alive today? Are you moving today? And this is what he says there. Paul says, we love them so much that we were willing to share. We love them so much that we were willing to share with them in delight. And I began to think, what would cause them to want to share anything in delight? He said, we love you so much that we were willing to share with you. And I thought, movement. What would cause you to share with your friends about Jesus? What would cause you to share in a world that says that we're a bunch of crackpots? We come here Sunday morning and we sing and we clap and we raise our hands and we verbalize Jesus' name and thank God for being in our lives. We claim to have a relationship with someone we cannot see. We claim to have a relationship with somebody that the rest of the world doesn't believe in. What can cause us under that kind of opposition to share with delight? Paul says, we were delighted to share with you. What could cause you to share with joy under great opposition? You know that many of us, man, I mean, we've tried to share with our friends and they get insulted and say, I don't want to hear about that stuff, right?
Amen.
And so we stop being aggressive in our sharing because it's embarrassing. I'm going to lose my friends. How many of you have lost friends when you came to the Lord?
Amen.
I know I have.
Amen.
I lost friends because they just didn't want to be bothered with me anymore. They couldn't deal with the way I'd become. Anyway, in this text here, Paul and Silas are in Thessalonica, a little town. And I began to say, he says, we loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you. I said, how could you delight to share with anybody after what happened to you? I want to give you some notes here. In the book of Acts chapter 14, verse 19 through 20, it speaks of how they stoned him in a little town called Lystra. In the book of Acts chapter 16, verses 22 through 23, and don't try to write all this down, that you can get a tape off of Ray later. Speaks of how they tore their robes off and they inflicted blows upon them. At this time, they were in a little town called Philippi, Jesus. And there was a little demonized girl, and they used to like this little demonized girl because she would be a prostitute at the temple, and everybody made money from her. But they were mad because Paul and Silas said a word and she was set free.
Amen.
And
Amen.
So they got mad at them. They tore their robes off, beat her with sticks, and threw them in prison. Think about it. Here, I'll give you another one. In the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 1, it says, they traveled to Thessalonica, and there they met opposition, and they fled under violent conditions also. What caused this character? What caused this kind of love under this kind of opposition? I mean, folks, what I'm talking about here now is that Paul had a reputation of a man that was a church splitter. He was a Jew. What caused this kind of love for these people? Hey, listen, I know some of you folks, somebody makes you mad, that's it. You blow them off, it's done. I don't want to see your face again. The very mention of your name makes me mad. People act like that, don't they?
Amen.
Can you imagine somebody smacking you in the face, trying to kill you, trying to hurt you, throwing you in prison, and accusing you, taking your clothes off, beating you up in a crowd, and yet you wake up in the morning and say, come on, Silas, let's go back, because I have such a love for them. I begin to think, is this delight that Paul had or insanity? Come on, you follow me?
Amen.
What could cause an individual, I won't say man, any one of you, what would cause an individual to delight? What would cause an individual to love a people that hate them? What would cause an individual to share anything with somebody that is trying to do you harm? What would cause that? And there we have our first vital sign, and that's the vital sign of movement. And look at what I put down here. Motion or movement is to be driven by a strong affection for another that motivates one to action. Now let me read that to you again. To be driven is to be driven by a strong affection for another that moves one to action. To be driven by a strong affection for another that moves one to action, or that motivates one to action. And I got to ask myself, was it a strong affection for the people in Thessalonica that moved into action? Was it a strong affection for the people in Philippi that moved into action? Was it a strong affection for the people in Lystra, those that beat him up, that led him to action? No. It was a yearning he had for God.
Amen.
You see, movement, to be motivated, means that you have a strong affection for something that moves you to action.
Amen.
You see, what he had here, Paul and Silas, they had been threatened and had their lives threatened. And they knew that these people, that when they went into these towns, that they were going to meet great opposition, that they were going to meet great discord, and that people were not going to be on the same page with them. And yet, what was this driving force that moved them to action? I tell you that it was that Paul had a yearning for God. Paul had met Jesus on the Damascus Road. He had been a Jew all his life, born of Benjamin, I trained under Gamaliel. He was a Pharisee, a member of the Sanhedrin, everything a Jew would want to be. And then he meets Jesus, and Jesus transforms his life. And when he transformed his life, he had this driving affection inside him that moved him to action. And friends are the ones that brought you here today. I want you to know that this church advocates, this church speaks, that if you have been changed by God, then it is your responsibility to tell somebody. How many of you would let a child cross the street if you knew a truck was coming? How many of you would let a child cross the street if you knew a car was coming? How many of you would let a child stick a little penny into a socket if you knew that the power was on?
Amen.
None of us would, because it would be our responsibility. be our moral obligation to warn you. So Paul was driven by a strong affection for another that moved him to action, and that affection was that he had a yearning for God. He had this love for God so much. It's not that he loved the people in Thessalonica that much, they just beat him up. Beat him up big time. Tossed him in jail. Snuck out in the middle of the night. Beat him up again. But he loved God so much that he knew God said, tell my people, man. Folks, families, friends, look around at the world now. Look around at the world. Larry King Live, two nights ago on CNN, had this new guy. Anybody ever hear me? He wrote these three books called Conversations with God. What a crackpot. They give him a half hour on Larry King. They give me 15 minutes on Larry King, I'd be dangerous.
That's
right. 15 minutes on Larry King. They give this guy, Richard, half hour spot where he's talking about that God spoke to him. And he wrote three books and they're bestsellers on the Times list now for 120 weeks straight. So he starts to interview him, and Larry King's a dog, man, because he's like, hey, how do you know God talked to you? What about Jesus? God didn't mention Jesus to me. He said, I'm good and I'm evil. God said, I'm Muslim and I'm Jewish and I'm Buddhist. God says I'm God, I'm not Jesus at all. God says that I'm good and bad. There's evil in me and there's good in me. God said I'm also male and female. God said all these things, God said. And he began to talk about how he has gotten so much acclaim for these books that now he's going to Europe this year. Somebody listen up. And he's getting the conference of churches together. And they are going to meet next year and do seminars all over the world to try to unify religions, to identify that, you know, everybody believes in a higher power. It's just the fine print where we're confused. I tell you, I'm not confused about the fine print that I was a heroin addict for 16 years and that Jesus was the only thing that could change me. I tell you, that was only part of the problem, because the whole other half of the problem was that there was so much emotional pain in me that I could not stand myself. I could not speak to another man. I could not stand to do it. I had such a low self-esteem. I tell you, I could crawl under a snake's belly. But I know that when I met Jesus, I know that something happened inside of me. I know that there was a transforming that took place in my life. And that's the reason that my yearning today drives me and motivates me to talk about Jesus. Nothing else is more important. Nothing else takes its place. Nothing else has top priority.
Thank you, Lord.
So the first vital sign is movement. Let me ask you, are you moving today?
Amen.
Are you driven by a strong affection for another that moves you to take action in your life?
Amen.
Think about that. Are you driven by a strong affection for God that it moves you to action? I know that some of you bought a friend today, actually knocked on somebody's door and bought somebody. I know some of you didn't, and I'm not taking this time to rebuke you. I'm just letting you know I'm putting you on check here. What's up, man? You scared? You scared? The vital sign of spiritual motion dictates that we are driven by a yearning, by a strong affection for something that drives you, that motivates you to action. The vital sign of movement. I know we're alive in the physical flesh, but how about in spirituality? Are we? Are we moving? Let me go on to the second vital sign, and that's the vital sign of pulse. Pulse. When I think of this, I think of that. Because every time my doctor puts this on me, when I hear that number coming down, I hear inside my arm, I think, oh man, something's up. You know, I would say, what is it? Am I okay? Am I okay? He says, yeah, you're fine. I go, good. Let me go home. Sometimes he tells me it's high sometimes. I've had my doctor tell me it's high. I said, it's high because I'm in your office. When I leave here, I'm going to be fine. I said, I can be in a congregation of people with a multiplex problem, but I can't go into my doctor's office and look at him and say, so am I all right? Come on, give me a check mark and get me out of here. Take my $32 and let me go home. Well, anyway, if you don't know about that, when you get over 40, you'll learn. Anyway, so the second vital sign is pulse. And here in the same text, pulse to me is to share what matters. Movement is to share with delight. Okay, number one, movement. He says, we love you so much that we were delighted to share with you. So movement is delight, even in opposition. Now understand me on that. Even when there's opposition, that you just have a joy to share. If you know not everybody's going to agree with you, but you just need to do what you need to do. Amen? Amen. And number two is pulse. The second vital sign is the sign of pulse. And that is to share what matters most. Take a look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 8 again. He says, we, so being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to share not only the gospel of God, or not the gospel of God only. Are you following me? First of all, he says, you beat us up, and we still like you, because God makes you. Then he says, but we were not only joyful and delightful about sharing with you. We not only knowing that there was a potential for another buck whipping coming back into your town. He says, but not only that, we were not only delighted to share with you, but we shared also what mattered most, the gospel of God, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Anybody follow me? Amen. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first, then also to the Gentile. Folks, the gospel, the good news, is the pulse of all life. It is the pulse of what we believe. All our religion, all our programs, all our buildings, all our propaganda needs to fade away at the pulse, at what drives the heart. And folks, my greatest concern is that I need to ask myself and ask you as a congregation, if you have truly been changed, and if you have truly experienced something from Jesus, then why don't you share it?
Amen.
I mean, if something has happened, if you had anxiety and it went away, if I had a disease and it is gone, if I had a bad past and it's gone, if my mind wasn't working right, and God heal me, if I'm sick right now, but God has given me peace in my heart, why won't I share?
Amen.
I get concerned about people that claim the promises of God and yet are ashamed and deny Jesus. Come on, are you following me?
Amen.
People get into this higher power concept. I believe in a higher power, and it's only one higher power.
Amen.
And that is God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
That's all it is. You cannot have God in everything, folks. You cannot have God in good and in bad. You can't have God in there and also in dog doo-doo. You can't have that.
Amen.
That's not God. These are the consequences of the creation of God. They are not God.
Amen.
If you go to India, they have 6 billion gods. Every frog and everything is a god.
Amen.
I don't want to, and listen, I don't want to reincarnate as anything. And if I did, I'm sure God would make a joke of me and reincarnate me as an Indian. Thought you'd appreciate that. Think about that. What is the pulse of your life? What's most important to you? Think about that. What is the pulse? What is inside your veins that is pumping up? I tell you, sometimes I look at Christians and I think you're comatose. Oh, I know there's a pulse there, but you're in a coma. But nothing. Spiritually, I'm talking about. Or not physically. I mean, physically, we're fine. But spiritually, it's like there's a faint. All you do is make it from service to service.
Mm.
Folks, the pulse of your spirituality must be Jesus.
Amen.
The motivating factor of your spirituality is that you love another so much that it drives you to action.
Amen.
But the pulse, the inside beat that caused the driving, the inside beat that causes motion, must be the good news that Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
Listen, many people, I know Muslims, and they believe in Jesus. They believe he was a prophet. Jews believe in Jesus. They believe he was just a good man that went wrong. I'll tell you, God's word says there is no other way whereby man can approach God but through the door, Jesus Christ.
Right.
I've had conversations with people that say, well, God being so great and powerful, why does God have to have Jesus? Because you and I need a mediator. God doesn't need one.
That's right.
I spoke to somebody a day ago and I said, if God is a holy God, if God is a true God, if God is the higher power, if God is the purest righteousness of everything, if God is just, how many of you believe all that?
Amen.
Amen.
Then he certainly couldn't stand next to you and I.
Amen.
Are you following?
Amen.
Amen.
If God is that powerful, that omnipotent, that omniscient, that you and I, as filthy rags as our dirty minds are, could not stand in his presence, or he would have to judge you. Because God says, be holy, for I am holy, and I cannot stand any unclean thing.
Amen.
How many of you are perfect? We have wings in the back for you. Just jump in it. And please don't leave out of the door with your wings. Go to the roof and jump, where we can watch you. Fly off. Not the roof, but the handle. The poor guest now saying, I ain't coming here no more.
Praise you, Father.
These are those people that wait for spaceships with Kool-Aid on the roof.
I praise you.
Think about that. In the Philippians book, chapter 3, verses 7, 8, and 9, in the Philippians chapter 3, verses 7, 8, and 9, take a look at Paul's life. Paul says this. He shares a little bit of his testimony. He says, but what things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but lost for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung that I might win Christ.
Amen. Amen.
That's Paul speaking, not Jimmy something. He says, I count them all lost. He said, I was the man. I was a Pharisee. I was a Sanhedrinite. I had servants. I was taught under Gamaliel, one of the greatest teachers of that time in the Middle East. He said, I was a Jew, a pure Jew, Benjaminite, circumcised on the eighth day. I had servants that would follow me around and do my beckoning call. Can you imagine having all that juice and giving it up? Can you imagine having all that power and saying it? Yeah, he says, but all things I had, I counted lost for Christ. Folks, that was the pulse. You see, something on the Damascus Road got inside of him. Something became real to him. There was an evidence. There was a presence of Jesus in him that began to pulsate, and it began to give him life in his spiritual man.
Amen.
And my question is that I'm scared that as a pastor, we are breeding a millennium of brand new religious people. And God is telling me, I want my spirit in them. I want Jesus to be the priority. My fear is that we're breeding nothing but spirituality. Martha, Mary, and the mystics. Or as George would say, spiritual Martha and the Vandellas. That's it, man. Everybody wants to wave banners and go like this now. That's it. And when I'm not doing that, I'm calling the psychic network because my little prayer group didn't tell me the right thing. Can you imagine they know we can't sleep. So they throw all that stuff on TV about you being fat, about you needing this new roller that costs $250. That ain't nothing more than a skateboard with two handles so that you can get your abs right. For the rest of your life. They know you can't sleep, and so all the insecurities about how you're eating it, they tell you, listen, one bad night on your Mac card and you done bought a juicer, an aromatizer, a complete nuclear gym, a tire bone tape, and a belt to make you lose weight on your belt. Not to mention that finally some program comes up. Oh no, and not only that, but he's cheating on you. Really? Could you see that? I knew it, you know, boom. Somebody you don't know. Tell me the world isn't looking for spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
They know you stayed up all night long and they sell us all that garbage, man.
Mm-hmm.
and we just raking it up, man. That's the Home Shopping Network, and we got a life. Waiting for the UPS man.
It's the truth.
A lot of giggling going on out
there. It's the truth.
A lot of giggling. You know, Pastor Lewis has a famous saying. He said, it was wonderful. I say it's famous because it's famous to me. He says, we cannot be entertained by the things we are trying to, what is it?
Overcome.
We cannot be entertained by the things we're trying to overcome.
Hallelujah.
Tell me what your problem is. You don't want to cuss no more? Then why are you watching Take That Cuss?
Amen. Come on now. Come on now.
Come on, folks. Don't look at me with that.
Come on now. Come on now. That's right. That's right.
I want to be faithful to my wife. And I want to, I can't wait for Aaron Brockovich to come out on video. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I cross the line? Oh, don't go there, John. I get it. All right. Just too spiritual, right? We expect too much from this lot. Come on, you follow me? Somebody say, don't leave me up here alone to die. I'm burning up up here. All I need now is to start being threatened. And I know why I delight so much in you. What's your pulse like? Come on, sir. What's your pulse like? Did he really change you? Did he change your life? Did he change your family? Why can't your neighbors see it?
Amen.
Why can't they see it yet? I love coming to church. Boy, at prayer time, I love coming to church. It's as if they hear my footsteps. As soon as I walk in, Father, thank you, Lord. Everybody gets spiritual. Really? No. I think it looks fine on you. I went with the smaller man because, he gives it more of the low ride effect and everything. And I walk in the door and folly, but praise God because hallelujah. And they be strutting up and down the altar, man, because everything is spiritual. What the pastor wants.
Preaching.
I'm trying to tell you.
Preaching. Right.
I think our time for gaming is up, man.
That's right.
If you're going to come, listen to me, and I want to invite you to to our prayer meeting at Friday, excuse me, at 5 o'clock here tonight.
Come.
5 o'clock. We're going to start our new prayer ministry.
Come. Amen.
It's going to be about praying.
I thank you, Lord.
Amen. 5 o'clock. Come on and meet me here. We'll have a good time of prayer. A genuine good time of prayer, okay?
Amen.
Finally, the third Bible sign. Tell me what the first one is again. Movement. To have such a strong affection for something that it moves you to action. And the second one is pulse. Pulse is sharing the only thing that's vital, and that's God's gospel of the good news. Amen. And the third one, finally, the third vital sign is that of breath. When you see somebody and you would go up there and see if there's, finally, I don't see any movement. I can't feel a pulse. And I would get down and I would go like that. And they'll usually get a little mirror and put it over the nostril and see if they can get a faint breath. To see if there's any air in there. And let me share this with you. Finally, the third one. And first, Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 8, the final part of the verse. It said, we love you so much that we were willing to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our own souls as well, because you have become so dear. Is everybody reading that?
Amen.
But our own souls as well. But our own souls as well. And I began to think, well, I know some of us will do number one. We'll be motivated to share and delight, even under opposition. We'll be bold and go out there. If the world doesn't like us, we'll pass out tracts and tell people to like Jesus. And there's some of us who will even share Jesus Christ and share the apostles. But the third Bible sign, when it comes to sharing your own life, we fall real short, don't we, church? I do something for you. I throw $20 in the plate. I even give $60, when it comes to me and my family, forget it there. It ended right there. And I wanted to share with you that here, Paul's ministry to these people would have been incomplete if he would not have wanted to share everything. Take a look at what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 14. I want to show you a powerful biblical principle here that is not happening in the churches today. You wonder why churches are caught up in the religious, churches are caught in religion, why pastors no longer preach with fire and with passion anymore. You wonder, you think, well, Pastor Jim, maybe it's because you're still a young man, you know what I mean, and you still haven't been settled down. You know, I don't think anything will ever settle me down. I got a passion for the Lord.
Amen.
Sometimes pastors get worried about their paycheck. They get worried about the board. They get worried about money. They get worried about what's going to happen if it falls through. What's going to happen if I upset a board member or something like that. And this is what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 14. He says, here for this third time, I am ready to come to you. He's trying to tell them, this is going to be my third visit to you. He says, and I will not be a burden to you, for I do not seek what is yours, but you.
Amen.
Amen.
See, he's showing us there that he's saying, you know, I'm not here for what is yours. I'm here for you. And folks, when I began to think that the word for souls means breath, in the Hebrew it means life, then he says, here for this third time, listen, we love you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our own souls as well. He was saying, not only was I moved into action, not only was there a driving pulse in me, he says, but I was willing to share my very breath with you. He says, I came here knowing that this time could be the time they kill me. This time could be the time when they finally throw me in prison and throw away the key. He says, and yet I was moved by this driving yearning for God to share with you the only thing that matters, the pulse of the gospel of Jesus. He says, and not only that, I would have given my soul as well because you had become dear.
Amen.
We need to get to a place where our friends become dear to us, church.
Amen.
Where our family members that we're disgruntled with become dear to us.
Amen.
You want them to see Jesus. You humble yourself for that attitude that you've had for 10 years.
Amen.
Call them up and say that you're sorry that you have been stubborn and thick-headed. You want them to see Jesus and say, oh yeah, well, he loves the Lord now. He's a religious guy now, but they're stuck up. They're stubborn. They're snobby. They think they're better than everybody. And folks, that's because we're not sharing our soul with them. They need to see that there is a residual change in us. They need to see that God has done a work in us. They need to see humility. They need to see repentance. They need to see real people going through real life issues, changing and coming through with joy. And that will cause them to say, you know, I want to know more about this Jesus you serve. I want to know more about this church. I want to know more about this God. The world right now takes us as a joke. The psychic network gets more attention than us. 1-800 numbers get more attention than us. It's a $1 billion industry. Think about that. Because people are looking for something. And we're supposed to be the living proof in every community that spirituality and genuine relationship with God exists. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Folks, I'm telling you, it cannot just be sharing the gospel with our mouth and with our mind. It can't just be the pulse of the word of God of what I know. Are you willing to share your soul? Are you willing to be transparent? Many of you, that's what you love about me, is that I'm transparent. That's why I asked you if you'd give me transparent pulpit, so that I can hide behind nothing. This is me. This is the package. This is what you get. And folks, when is it going to be that we share our souls? You know, I'll give you the greatest example of all three vital signs. Jesus. I'm thinking about it. I'm done here. Jesus. The creator of all things. Comes into the Garden of Gethsemane and said, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not my will, but thine be done. And some people say, oh yeah, well that proves he wasn't God there. No, he was just showing his human side. That there was pain and affliction.
Amen. Amen.
He said, yet not my will, but thine be done. You see, that was the vital sign of movement. He was moved with compassion. For who? For his father. He said, yet not my will, but thine be done. He was moved with compassion for his father. Then he said, I'll do it. I'll do it. To share the good news and to heal the afflicted. Think about everything that they ever said about Jesus. This man hangs with sinners. This man eats with them. He goes into people's homes that are lepers. We saw him with a leper last week, touching a leper. Oh, he walked on water, but he touched a leper too. Think about that. He was moved with compassion now, with a yearning to please his Father that he would love us. Did we reject him? Is the world now rejecting him? They smacked him, and they stuck him, and they pulled his beard out, stuck a crown of thorns on him, nailed him to a tree, made him carry his own tree, whipped him overnight, kept him away, spit in his face. Think about it. Did that make him stop loving you?
Nope. Thank you, Jesus.
Can you see what I mean?
Yeah.
There was a pulse there of something greater. Folks, our little bounty is going to hell in a handbasket. If you take a look at the Gallup poll now, they have a brand new book out, and it speaks about the new spirituality that people are hungry for. And young people of my age, about the 40 and 50, 60 age, are hungry for it. They want something more. Friendships, now that we're getting older, we're starting to realize that our hair is falling out and our belly, we can't control our abs anymore. And now finally, we got two friends maybe one we can trust, and even that one we're questionable and can't really bear our hearts. We lay next to someone at night and we call them spouse, and they don't even know us. The only thing we share is the mail. Did we get any mail today? Did you check the messages?
Amen.
Anybody problem?
Amen.
Where's the life in that? George said it best. He said, there's a chemical spill over in his neighborhood, so they wouldn't let him in his house for 3 days, and he's been at our house. He thinks it's been an eternity, we just glad to have him around. But he said, I'm too old to be worried about every little thing anymore. I want some good friends in my life. Somebody gave me a card here last week, one of my birthday cards. Man, I mean, it brought a tear to my eye, it broke me down. I said, thank you, Pastor Jimmy, for being the town manual. Thank you for being so clear and transparent with us. I hope I grow old together. I hope that our families get to grow old together. Man, that's a visionary. That's somebody saying, I want something more than just a spiritual kind of a religious type of religion. Well, it's Sunday. Let's go to church. Come on, let's go. You know, most fights happen on the way to church. Shut up, you know, get dressed. You're not embarrassed me when you get in there. Don't you say that movie we watched. If I hear you mention it, any of those other fools. Most fights happen on the way.
That's right.
You didn't know I knew. Am I brilliant or am I just human? Because right now how things are going, crosses in the next 10 years will be taken down and replaced with just little banners to say statements like, you know, I lift him up, God be praised. We're going to take the cross down altogether. And it won't be long before we replace it with a moose head. Turn these things into a big giant club and put bass around the walls and stuff like that. Just turn into a lodge. I'm sorry for you fishermen. I know trout season's coming soon. Most people in the church that day take off work.
Never.
Listen, let me talk to you for a second in closing. Jesus was the greatest servant.
Amen.
Folks, if you came here today, I want to thank you. I want to ask you, what are your vital signs? Spiritually. I know you're alive because you're here. Most, you know, I can see in your eyes because I'm scanning the room and no one has fallen asleep on me yet, which is a good thing. But what are your vital signs? Are you alive spiritually? I know you're alive physically. Is there a driving force in your life? Is there something that moves you to action? Is there a pulse in your life? Something that you live by, that nothing else takes the priority of that? And is that priority Jesus? And are you willing to love this valley and these lost people? People maybe of a different color, maybe of a different sex, maybe of a different social status. Are you willing to love them so much that you would share your soul with them and say, this is important? And the greatest trap of the devil is to keep us selfish and into our own families and minds. And when he makes you that way, and you're selfish at home too, and you don't realize that your whole family is growing up right in front of your eyes, and you don't even realize it.